Good evening. It's good to have everybody back. Hope y'all had a great afternoon. Hope you ladies got to sit and let the men do the work. At my house, that's exactly what happened. Darla got to sit, and she loved it. So, well, I say that. It was kind of hard not to get up and say, oh, y'all need to do this, y'all need to do that. But she did well. Okay, a few announcements. Our sympathy goes to Wayne and Glenda King and their family on the passing of their brother-in-law, Gary Aday, of Elkhorn, Wisconsin. Gary and his wife were former members of Southwest many years ago. Please keep Wayne, Glenda, and their family in your prayers. I mentioned this morning that Troy Manuel passed away yesterday. Jan's husband passed away yesterday. And his service is Tuesday evening from 5 to 7 at Criswell's, and it'll be a come and go. I think we're going to see more of those as time goes along. But you get to have a personal time with Jan, maybe. And then also, Alan and Alan Stonecipher's mother, Shirley Stonecipher, had surgery this morning. As far as I know, everything went well. She had to have a hip replaced after falling and breaking her hip. So please keep that family in your prayers as well. I'm not aware of any other announcements at this time. Does anybody have anything? Okay, well, we'll begin with our prayer and a song. So.
Would you bow with me, please? Our God, our Father in heaven, we are grateful for this this evening that we can come together as brothers and sisters in Christ and to praise you, to sing these songs of praise, and to hear another portion of your word, Father. We're grateful for the word that you have left for us, so that way we may come to know you and to know you better. Father, we pray that you'll be with Brian tonight as he brings to us another lesson. We pray that the words that are said tonight, that we will each apply them to our lives and strive to grow closer to you each day. Father, we're mindful of the ones that were just announced, the ones that have lost loved ones recently. We pray that that your hand of comfort will be with them, that you will also be with the ones that had recent surgeries or undergoing surgeries today. We pray that that you'll be with the doctors, the nurses as they recover, and we pray that they will do the very things that will restore them to their much-wanted health. Father, we're grateful, most importantly, for your son and for the love that was shown to us by sending him to this earth to be the perfect example of how we're to live, but to be the perfect sacrifice on the cross for our sins, Father. And we ask that you help us to reflect on that, not only on Sundays, but to reflect on that each day of our lives and to strive to grow closer and to live like Christ. Father, we ask that as we continue into this service that you continue with us, help us to dismiss the thoughts and cares of this world and to focus on the words that we sing and the lessons that are being taught. And it's in Christ's name we do pray.
Our first song will be As the Deer.
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you.
Thank you.
shall assemble on the mountain.
We shall assemble at the throne.
Unto thee, O
Lord,
do I lift up my soul.
This will be the song before the lesson. Could we please stand for this song?
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer.
Spirit, we long to embrace you.
Is podium on? There we go. All right. Since you guys reminded me of cheese and popcorn this morning, I thought we'd talk solid food tonight. And we are going to be talking throughout the month of May about spiritual growth. Thornton did a good job kicking us off last week with that. It was really odd to come to church in a polo and jeans last Sunday night. Didn't quite know what to do, but I thoroughly enjoyed it. So, Thorne, you can do that much more often. It'd be okay with me. We'll start with an obvious question. Does God expect us to grow? Now, I get the fact that God expects us to grow physically, clearly. Some of us are probably better than others. But God expects that of us. But spiritually speaking, does God expect growth out of us? Now, I like to think this is one of those obvious questions that when we ask, it's almost kind of answered already just because we're here. But at the same time, I would imagine we could look around a lot at folks that we know, not us, of course, but other folks that we know who are following God, and realize it doesn't seem like a lot of growth has gone on there. And maybe we get frustrated with people like that. Maybe as we look in Scripture, we find people along the way like that, and we get frustrated with them a little bit when they do the wrong things. But this question that should be obvious, it seems like a lot of folks live in such a way that doesn't make the answer seem as obvious. So we'll answer it in the way that I think you expect it to be answered, and then we'll kind of go from there as to what that means for us as Christians. In Matthew 5, we find the Sermon on the Mount, and toward the end of the first chapter of that, we read that says, "For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not only even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect." So does God expect us to grow? I think clearly he does. And he ends this by saying, you must be perfect. And I get to the end of chapter 5 and I step back from my Bible and I almost want to close it for a minute and just say, well, okay, is that all? I've just got to be perfect now? And for a lot of us, we have read this verse along the way and others like it along the way in Scripture. And I think we have come away with the wrong idea, because we have learned somewhere in life that being perfect is really not an option, is it? When it comes to humanity, when it comes to people, do you know anybody who has lived a perfect life? I think we know one, and he's the guy doing the preaching in Matthew chapter 5. But aside from that, there's really just nobody that is perfect. As good as you are, at whatever you're good at, whether it's your profession or a hobby that you're really good at, as good as you are at that, there are times where you mess up doing that thing. And there are a lot of times, by the way, if you're really good at it, that even your mess up, you're good enough that you kind of cover it and people don't really notice. But yet there are times where we mess up, and it's in those times that we recognize, I'm not perfect. I'm not as good at this as I may think I am. Or maybe there are other times that even though you haven't messed up, you see someone else who does it better than you do. I was a trumpet player in high school and college, and I was pretty good at it for a while until I met people that were a lot better at it than I was. And then I realized that even though I'm playing the right notes and I'm playing the right rhythm and I'm playing the things musically that are on the page in the right way, this guy does it a whole lot better than I do. And just the way he does it, if you were to listen to me and then to listen to him, you would think, oh yeah, I'd much rather listen to that other guy because what he did sounds a little closer to perfect. So when we see perfect here at the end of the first third, I guess, of the Sermon on the Mount, it would be easy for us to step back and think, who can do that? Who can be perfect? But I want you to think about perfect in the way the word is actually used in the Greek language. The word is teleos, which means perfect, is the way it's translated a lot of times, but it also frequently is translated mature. And the noun form of the verb actually is translated almost all the time as end, like something has reached its end. So if something is perfect, it is you have completed that thing. Brett Butler, a couple weeks ago on Facebook, posted a picture of himself on his mountain bike on a trail. And ever since I saw that, I wanted to go to that trail because it looked like a really fun place. So Friday, I got my mountain bike off the wall of my garage where it belongs, and I got it down. It is the first time it has been off the wall of the garage since I put it on the wall of the garage when we moved here. And I got it down. Tires were very flat, and so I got my inflator out and inflated the tires. I realized that the sides of my seat had begun to dry rot. It had been on the wall for so long. And so I rubbed off, literally with my hand, rubbed off a layer of the seat covering to make it where I could ride on it, put it on the bike rack, drove down to Sulphur to where this lake is that he rode around, and I rode around this lake. And about the first half, I was pretty enthused about my riding. And I thought, this is going pretty well. I like this. And then about midway through, I hit a pretty good-sized hill. Brett did not warn me of this on Facebook. And so I hit this hill and I kept going down in gears. This was the point, by the way, that I learned that one of my gears I could not go into because the gears were not adjusted properly because it hadn't been ridden in so long. And so I struggled up this hill and then finally began to coast down another hill. And I was very excited when I got around to the other side and had completed the circle. And then I had to decide for a moment, do I want to do this again? And so I did again. The hill was much higher the second time. And I got around it again, and I decided two laps is good for today. And I looked at the little map on my phone that I had started trying to figure out where I was, and I had completed that course around the lake. And that is kind of what is being talked about here in Matthew 5. It is the idea of completing something, the idea of an end of something. And so as Christians, what we're doing is trying to move towards a goal, trying to move towards an end. And even a lot of times as we read about Jesus being made perfect, there's a part of that that we understand that Jesus is perfect as the Son of God, but a lot of times what is being said is that Jesus has completed the task that he came here to do, and so that we receive salvation because of that completed task. So I want you to think in terms of that as we look at a few more verses here. In 1 Corinthians 14, verse 20, it says, "Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature." That same word that we have translated as perfect in Matthew 5, translated as mature here. So God says to us, if you're going to be childish somewhere, let the childish side be evil, and then be mature in the side that is good. Then in Ephesians 4, and we've come back to Ephesians 4 a few times, but it applies to a lot of things we're talking about recently. We read about he gave some to do all these different things, and then says midway through there, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So this mature manhood that he mentions here is that same word. It is the perfection. It is the end of things. And again, until we all attain that. So there was never an intent that we would all show up here on a Sunday morning or on a Sunday evening or whenever, and that we would all just kind of do this at different levels of commitment. There was always an intent of God, if we're going to follow his Son and try to be like him, that we would all be moving toward that end, that we would all be moving towards the completion of the task, the maturity that we're going to have, which again, when I asked the question at the beginning, does God expect us to grow? Does God expect us all to reach a much higher level of spirituality than where we are currently, or even more so than where we began? I think the answer to that throughout Scripture is pretty clear. Here the expectation is that we're all going to attain this kind of maturity. So where do we begin? If you believe that Scripture teaches us that we are supposed to grow, and if you believe also, based on your life experience, that not everyone is doing that, and maybe you have personally had some times where you feel like that, maybe you're personally there right now, or maybe you have known plenty of people that you think there just doesn't seem to be a lot of growth happening there, where do we start to grow? So in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11, the Hebrew writer says this, "About this we have much to say, and it is hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing." So where we begin, and we talked about this a little 2 weeks ago as we talked about evangelism, we begin with listening. I still have forgotten to look at the number of how many we had here this morning. It was a big crowd for Mother's Day. But one thing I really noticed that I have not noticed in a long time is standing in the back as people were coming out, making comments about things, even with your masks off for the most part now, I was having a hard time a little bit hearing everything that was being said. And clearly some of you were having a hard time hearing what I was saying, I could tell. And it was all of the noise around us, which was wonderful, by the way, to hear all of the noise around us. But it was kind of hard to listen. And our world's kind of the same way. There is so much noise around us, trying to distract us, trying to move us in different directions, that we have to begin this time of growth, this objective of growth in our Christian walk by listening. We have to pay attention to Scripture. We have to pay attention to what's going on around us. We have to pay attention to one another. And then he continues. He says, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food." So secondly, we have to be honest with ourselves. This is maybe the hardest part of it. I've mentioned to you several times along the way. Every now and then I'll run into something that I'm preaching about or teaching about, and I feel ill-equipped. I feel like somebody else should be doing that because I know how lacking I am in whatever the thing is that I may be talking about at that point. we need to be able to see ourselves in that way, to realize that I am not quite where I want to be yet. And there's then, do I feel down on myself because of that, or do I strive to get better? And when we do other things in life, I think we understand how that works, don't we? We understand that we don't just start off where we want to be. It's a continuous movement along, trying to grow, trying to get better, trying to do more. And when we see that in other things in life, we get it. We understand that if I go out to the bike trail again next Friday and I put my bike, the tires are already inflated, so I've saved some time there, and I put it on the bike rack and I drive up to Sulphur and pay my toll on the turnpike again, and I get off at the Veterans Lake there and start riding around the trail, that probably the third lap will be a little easier. Maybe the fourth lap will be a little easier as you do that time after time after time. And for us as Christians, as we see all of this, what we're doing, we begin by realizing that I'm not quite where I want to be yet. And then he talks about going to milk. What is milk for Christians? We oftentimes will read these verses, by the way, and there are three or four that we could choose from about milk and solid food when it comes to our Christian walk. We read this, and a lot of times we look at the milk negatively, because it's as if we want to get to the solid food. That's where we want to be. And the milk almost seems like it's punishment. The milk almost seems like it's something that you're just not capable of the solid food, so you have to begin with the milk. But the milk for us as Christians is Scripture. This is where all of our foundation begins. We have so many babies around here, which is just fun to watch and hear the sounds and all of those things. I try to imagine, you know, one of those babies as they come home from the hospital or in their home for a couple days, if you just throw a steak out in front of that child and then just wait, what are they going to do? You know, for the first little while, look at it. They're going to reach a point where they're teething. They'll probably chew on it for a while, but not do anything else with it. There comes a point where that is going to be a delicacy. That's going to be something that people look forward to, at least for the meat eaters among us. But for the little child, it's not what they need. And so what the Hebrew writer says here is, it's the milk that you begin with. It is the milk that begins everything for you in spiritual growth. And so if we are not growing, we begin by, we've got to listen better. We've got to be honest with, where am I as a Christian? Where am I in my growth process? And then we go to Scripture, because Scripture is where all of that foundation is built. And so if I don't feel like I'm growing as a Christian, I must begin in the Word of God. But solid food is for the mature. And by the way, again here, you will find that same word, the idea of complete, perfect, mature. For those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. So constant practice, I think, is something we get in every part of life other than Christianity for some reason. In every part of life other than growing in our relationship with Jesus for some reason. Now, I debated for a while. I don't want to come across as bragging or anything like that, but I hope this will make it all make sense. The reason why I did two laps around the lake is because I had done 22 miles on the recumbent bike that morning at home in front of my TV. For an hour and a half, I just pedaled 15 miles an hour and just pedaled and pedaled and pedaled and pedaled. And then somewhere midday, I thought, this would be a fun day to go ride around a lake, wouldn't it? Which was a bad idea, by the way. But my legs were already tired, and then I got out there and I went a little further. Now, what I will tell you is, on that Friday, it was the end of 6 weeks of doing something like that every day. Now, it's not 22 miles every day. It's usually more like 13 or 14, something like that. Before I reached those 6 weeks, there is no way I could have pedaled twice around that lake. No way at all. And what it took was constant movement in that direction. We get that with everything about life. I looked at the Neils on their recent vacation. They had pictures of scuba diving, which looks really cool to me and terrifying all at the same time. The idea of being close to all the ocean life and all that stuff is really neat, but at the same time, I'm afraid. And I looked, and for the first couple days, they were having to learn about how to do that. They were having to get certified in things, because for whatever reason, they don't just toss you out in the ocean with a tank and say, hey, come back here in about an hour and a half. They teach you how to do all those things. Now, as Christians, the Hebrew writer here is saying, you have to learn how to do all these things. You have to figure out where you're at. You have to use Scripture as your milk to get there. And then you have to realize that this is going to take constant practice. Now, if we are truly honest with ourselves and we feel like growing, if we were to look in the mirror and ask the question, am I practicing anything that would make me grow as a Christian in my relationship with God in a way I would describe as constant practice? I would imagine that most people that feel like they're not growing would answer that question with a no, if they're being honest. And honestly, a lot of us that feel like maybe we're kind of neutral or growing a little bit would probably feel like we're not doing enough practice. Because if we cared about it to the level we care about other things, wouldn't we do it at least that kind of level, if not more? And if God has called us to be Christians, called to be people who are known by love, called to be people who are disciples, who are making more disciples, wouldn't we pour time and energy and effort into getting better, into growing? And clearly we would, but I would imagine the church here in America especially is probably characterized by not a whole lot of constant practice. So I said this morning, I don't usually guilt you in anything. Maybe I'm doing it twice today. Maybe we should practice more than we do. And I don't know what that looks like for you. There are those of you that if I were to throw you on my recumbent bike in our office with the TV in front of you for an hour and a half, you would be either huffing and puffing or bored to tears within about 6 minutes. And you'd be tired of it. And believe me, I was right there with you on week one. There would be those of you that eat that stuff up. There would be those of you that if I put you in scuba training, learning how to do scuba diving, that you would love that and think it was the opportunity of a lifetime. And there are those of you that not so much. And when it comes to things of Christianity, clearly there are a lot of things that we are all called to do, but each of us is equipped to do those things differently. But we are equipped to do those things. Not doing them is not an option that we have. Just sitting back and being a casual observer to the Christian walk is not an option we've been given. We have been called to be people who do these things, and as we do them, we grow and begin to do those things better. He continues in chapter 6, and this chapter division is just here because translators threw that in somewhere along the way. I think this very much relates to what we just read. Therefore, as David talked about the therefores this morning, therefore let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. So there's going to be a transition. We are leaving the elementary things behind. I was thinking this week, as Nathan was taking a college algebra test at some point, he was telling me about the difference in math then as when math was learned early on. I remember as a second grader him coming home with the addition tables that he had to learn. I don't know if you have to do this anymore with Common Core, but this is how it used to work. There was a page full of things you had to add. And you add all these numbers, and they've been referred to as a time test by all his teachers throughout the year. They would get to the point they did this time test, and there was a front and back. And they started out by trying to get the front done, and by the time they got done, what they were trying to do was do the front and the back of this addition page in under 2 minutes. And when you got to under 2 minutes, they got to celebrate with an ice cream sundae with the teacher. And all the class got to watch this happen, which probably couldn't happen anymore either, because now you'd have like people who are getting rewarded and not, and anyway. So the first time he did the test, the teacher told us it didn't go very well. He didn't get any of them right. And we thought, hang on, Nathan's really good at math. What happened? And what we saw when we saw the paper was he had multiplied. Skipped right on past addition and subtraction, and he had multiplied the stuff on the sheet because it was a times test. And so he had gone through and timesed all of these things, and we thought, well, that's pretty cool, and that'll happen like a year down the road, but, you know, come back to it. Now, he was advancing beyond, but now, to look at college algebra or to look at trig he was taking last semester, all the things that are on the ACT that he just took, there's all this stuff that we learn in math that I have now forgotten somewhere along the way. Those elementary things we put behind us. As Christians, are we putting the elementary things behind? Now, that's not to say that we forget them. Because what we learn, especially in math of all places, but in lots of other topics too, is don't we take those things and then begin to build on them? Don't we take the things that we learn on that addition page that is front and back, and then somewhere down the road we begin to build on those things? My wife for Mother's Day made me plant shrubs yesterday. No, she actually said, you don't have to do this if you want, but I'm doing it. And as a husband, I know what that means. So I went out there and I helped plant shrubs. I dug holes. She put them in and I said, yes, that looks straight. As we were going through and digging all of these holes and putting all of these shrubs in, I realized these things are, they're starting small and then they're going to grow. And the things that we learn, they begin small and then they just continue to grow and to grow and to grow. And as we looked at these things, we realized, you know, it seems kind of sparse now, but we know based on the little card that comes in the shrub, this thing should grow 18 inches in all direction and about this tall, and all of this is going to fill all of this space. For us as Christians, are we growing in such a way where everything begins to fill the space that God has created for us? And if we're not, are we willing then to do that? And so he says there's going to be this transition, which for us is growth, or maybe if we think of it more in Bible terms, transformation. We are turning into something that is greater than where we began. One of the plants we looked at, one of the things my wife liked about it was not so much the way it looked, although she liked that, or the size of it, although she liked that. It was, it attracts butterflies and hummingbirds. And that was the thing that spoke to her. It filled the space right, and it was going to be the right size and all those things, but the idea of there being butterflies and hummingbirds all around there, she liked that. And I think to myself of those butterflies and hummingbirds, again, with butterflies especially, the idea of transformation. That butterfly, I just can't imagine the butterfly yearning to be a caterpillar again. And for us as Christians, how many Christians seem to yearn for the things they used to have instead of what lies ahead? How many of us in our spiritual lives are like those children of Israel out in the wilderness, talking about how things used to be, and instead of moving forward to the promised land that's been prepared for us. So as we grow, we are transforming. And then in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17 says, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. So we are rooted and grounded in love. Now, part of the process I found as I volunteered to dig the hole, mainly because I didn't want to be responsible for everything being straight and in the right lines and facing the right way and all those things, I thought, digging, I probably won't mess that up too much. Every now and then, I would hit a root of something. And then I would start pulling, and at one point, there I pulled a root out that pulled like halfway across the shrub bed that we were doing, and I thought, man, this is crazy. When we begin to grow and build these roots, keeps coming back. We had weeded that entire shrub area 3 weeks ago. And when we went out there to plant some more stuff again, there's the weeds again. They're back. And I tried to dig a little deeper and weed a little deeper this time. And I'm going to guess that there's a pretty good chance some of those are going to be back again 3 or 4 weeks from now. God in our lives, the things of Scripture in our lives, as we root in love, as we're grounded in love, those things continue to hold us firm. Those things continue to provide us with nourishment. Those things continue to help us to grow. And so it's important how we begin, but also that we don't just stay there. Continuing on, they may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. We can comprehend and know when we are growing. How many of us want to know more about God, to understand him better, to know more about Jesus, to know more about his word? How do we get there? We grow. We study. We have constant practice. And as we continue moving that direction, we learn more and more about God. Do you know more about God and about Jesus than you did the day you came up out of the water? I hope so. And if you don't, I will tell you the things that we're talking about tonight are what are going to get you there. In Philippians chapter 3, Paul writes, not only that I have obtained this, or I'm already perfect, again, by the way, perfect, mature, and the same word, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature, again, same word, think this way, and if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you, also to you. So we're constantly moving forward. If we feel like we're stuck in a rut, the key to that is continuing to move forward. I'm pressing on. And think about, just for a moment, the words of Paul here. I don't consider myself to already be there. I would hope, and believe me, by the way, there are a lot of people in this room that when I look at you, I feel like you're there. You know, you have attained something I am trying desperately to get to, and you have made it, and I follow your example. But I hope there is never a moment that you think it. I hope we are always feeling like Paul. Think of the life that Paul leads. Think of the fact that here is a man who is has this vision of Jesus right there on the road to Damascus, who is blinded and then unblinded as he's baptized, who has completely transformed his life and turned it around, who boldly proclaims, who is stoned to the point of death, left for dead, gets back up, continues doing it again, who has run out of town more than one time, who is taken prisoner, freed, taken prisoner again, who lives his life in this way that he would say, I've not attained maturity yet. I'm not there yet. For us, that should tell us, if nothing else, we are not there yet either. Wherever you feel like you are in your Christian walk, however great many great things you've done, there is always more to do, always more growing that can happen, always more we can learn, always more practice that can happen. Do you know, I heard this week, I debated about saying it, but I'm going to say it and you can run me out of town later. Do you know retirement is not a Bible concept? Now, I get a lot of folks have retired. I'm glad you've retired, and I've mentioned this before. I find retired people to be the busiest people I know, generally speaking. But when it comes to the Christian walk, when it comes to church, retirement is not a Bible concept. The idea that I have now gotten this thing done and I'm going to move on to something else or to let somebody else, it's just not there. And so for us, as we look around at one another and think, you know, I've done this. I'm finished. There is more to do. There is still a world out there that needs to know about him. There are still people here who can be encouraged. And I will tell you, by the way, I don't think we have a large problem with this here because some of our retired folks encourage me more than anybody I can imagine. And so I know you're at least doing the encouraging and probably a whole lot more things that I don't see. But here we see that Paul does not see that he has attained it. He just keeps moving forward. He just keeps growing and learning. He also writes in 1 Thessalonians 4, "Finally then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and please God, just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus." So we're going to keep doing this more and more. How much should we grow? More and more. How much further do I need to go? How much more do I need to do for God? More and more. Wherever we are at, there is always something that's more to do. This is the same man wrote for me to live as Christ and to die as gain. He believed that. He knew that if he went on, there was something much better for him, but there is so much more to do. And then in Romans 8, we know 28 very well. We know 31 pretty well for the most part. Those verses in between get kind of lost. So I thought we'd start with the familiar and get to the in between and end there. And we know that for those who love God and for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. But then in verse 29, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. Those whom he called, he justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. So how do we grow? We be like Jesus. He called us to be conformed to the image of his son. And so as we look and we try to figure out, okay, I'm not where I want to be and I know I need to go further. But how do I get there? The New Testament is filled with the example of how to get there. Because Jesus grew. Jesus grew not just as an infant into a man, but Jesus grew in his relationship with others. Jesus grew in his relationship with the Father. And Jesus shows us what it is to be someone who follows God. So as we take this journey on over the next few weeks, I want you to think about specifically for you, and I don't know what it is for you because it's a little different for each of us, where is an area in your walk with God that you could grow? And then I want you to think secondly, what can you do to get there? I want you to try to, it's hard sometimes to think about Bible things in other ways. We get this in everything else in life. I want you to bring that mentality into scriptural things for a minute. What can you do to change that? If you feel like there's a place that you need to grow, how can you begin to do that? And I would encourage you, even if you're not a list maker, that you will put a couple steps on paper or put them in your phone or set alarms on your phone as a reminder or put them on a sticky note and put it on your mirror or do something that does not let you let go of this. And if you think to yourself, you know, a place I need to grow is in my prayer life, then what if you set an alarm on your phone at a particular time every day to remind you to pray? If the place I need to grow is in my reading of Scripture, what if you put a Bible somewhere you cannot miss it, open to where you want to be reading, and you walk by that and see it every day and are reminded, I need to sit down and I need to read my Bible? What if the place you feel like you need to grow is I need to be more encouraging of other people? What if you go down and buy a little box of encouragement cards and send one of those to somebody? If the way you need to grow is the way I talk with my family and the way we interact, what if you come up with a plan to grow in that way? If the way you need to grow is the things we talked about last month with telling other people about Jesus, what if you begin to think about your one and maybe some more specific steps you can take to get there? And I guarantee you that God, as we have read tonight, will be pleased by that. God will be pleased by the fact that we are not content to be static and stay where we are, but instead to go further and closer to Him in our walk. Tonight, if you have never begun that walk, you got a lot of growing ahead. And it's a great place to begin with this milk of Scripture and then take yourself onto heights that you cannot begin to imagine and do things for God that you didn't know were possible and see God transform you in ways that you didn't think you could even be transformed, because it is His power at work and not ours. Or if you have sat static for too long, this may not be a come up here kind of thing, but maybe in your own mind, in your heart, in your prayers today, you can recommit yourself to grow and to change and to be more of who God designed you to be. If we can help you some way in all those things, please come as we stand and sing.
Encamped along the hills of life, ye Christian soldiers rise and press the battle and the night, to bear with glowing skies against the floating bears below. Let all our strength be heard. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world.
If you did not have an opportunity to take the Lord's Supper this morning, you can find it in the classroom behind the foyer. Our last song will be A Common Love. A common love for each other.
Oh.
Let's pray. Our Father, we're thankful for this opportunity to be here, the chance to sing praises to you, to fellowship with one another, to hear a lesson from your word. We're thankful for these days that we're able to get together for this reason. Father, we pray that as we strive to mature in our faith, that we don't forget or forego the elements that we learn from Scripture, but we take those principles and we apply those to ourselves and our lives as we interact with one another and with the world around us. Father, we're thankful for Jim and Martha. We're thankful for the impact that they've had on us as a congregation and us as individuals. And we pray that you will bless them as they move on to live near their family. And we're thankful for the time that we had with them. And we're thankful for the impact that they've had for us. We pray that you'll be with all of those of our number who have recently graduated, either from college or high school, and pray that you'll be with each one of them as they move on to the next things that they're facing and they're coming up to in their lives, that you will bless them in that. Pray that you'll be with the families who are celebrating new babies, that you will bless that journey that they are beginning, and help us to encourage them in that. And we pray that you'll be with those families who have recently lost loved ones, that you will give them comfort, help us to provide comfort to them. We ask that you'll be with us as we go through this week. Help us to be the example we need to be, and forgive us when we fail to do that. It's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.